Hello, everybody. This is Wen Chang. Thank you for joining me. It is an honor and a privilege to share my thoughts with you on a novel approach to rotator cuff exercises. This is of particular importance, as we know, to all throwing athletes for shoulder health and shoulder performance. Although the underhand motion in softball windmill pitching is not as stressful to the shoulder joint as the overhand pitching in baseball, but they both share similar patterns of delivery, the preparatory phase, acceleration, deceleration, and the follow-through. In both, the greatest forces and torques subjected by the shoulder occur during the acceleration and deceleration, and we also know that although the true driving force for all pitches come from the lower half of the body, even though less than 20% of the power come from the shoulder, but they may account for more than 80% of all career-ending injuries for pitchers. Well, let's start with a video to understand why that is so. Okay, what's the commonality? Race cars skid out. Shoulders blow out. Race cars skid out because the tires did not grip. The shoulders blew out because the rotator cuff could not stabilize. With any arm motion, there are 17 muscles involved in moving the shoulder. But of all those 17, only four, the rotator cuff muscles, serve as the stabilizers. So we are in constant battle of the four stabilizing muscles versus the 13 power movers with any shoulder movement. This creates a muscle imbalance of 20% fighting against the 80%, sets up injury pattern. The rotator cuff is always the weak link in the shoulder. As we know, any chain is only as strong as its weakest link, and any team perhaps may be only as strong as its weakest player. More than 90% of all non-contact shoulder injuries are due to rotator cuff failure. This is because of overuse, acute overload, or improper mechanics. Acute overload, we understand, could be intangible injuries happen. Improper mechanics, that's why we beg for proper coaching and proper training. Overuse is the most common of all the causes, the most common cause that we see as physicians in the office for shoulder complaints. Overuse is a result of underconditioning. Well-conditioned athletes never suffer from overuse. So that is why we all understand the importance of strengthening the rotator cuff. But the question is, how do we strengthen the four rotator cuff muscles that lie deep under the shoulder and to peel it away from all the influence of the large muscles that cover the shoulder? How do we ever separate out the four rotator cuffs from the other 13? The anatomy of the hip gives us a bony capsule that securely grabs onto the head of the hip for security. The shoulder joint does not have the luxury of this bony capsule, and there's a potential space there for any movement to occur. Therefore, all the stability in the shoulder must come from the rotator cuff muscles. These four muscles crop out like a hand with four fingers, grab onto the head of the humerus as a ball. So, what is the real function of rotator cuff? Here's an x-ray of my own shoulder, which is normal. And you can see that the humeral head has a center that is well aligned to the center of the glenoid, the opposing bone. As the arm moves up into a different position, the center is still aligned. Moving further up, the center is maintained. Moving up, well aligned. Here's a video that demonstrates the shoulder in motion. You see the smooth, stable, well-aligned shoulder joint during motion. The rotator cuff muscles crop out like a hand, grabbing the top of the humeral head, with all four muscles contracting simultaneously, working as one functional unit, pulling the head toward the glenoid. This anchors the humeral head abutted against the glenoid and allow arm motion around its fulcrum. When the rotator cuff is torn or deficient, the result is muscle imbalance and asymmetric migration of the humeral head. Here we see a normal x-ray of intact rotator cuff. You see the center of the humeral head is well aligned to the center of the glenoid. This is an x-ray of an individual with advanced, what we call rotator cuff tear arthropathy with absent rotator cuff. There's abnormal migration of the humeral head upwards. Here is a model of the humerus that is lined against the glenoid. Tendency is for the shoulder to move upward because of the absence of the space there. The function of the rotator cuff is to contract simultaneously all four muscles so as to come out like my hand again, grabbing onto the ball. This opposing force is what they call a force couple. The rotator cuff force direction functioning against the deltoid force direction. With the shoulder movements, exercises that we do in the internal rotation, we activate the anterior internal rotators. The shoulder rotates internal rotation. External rotation by firing the posterior external rotators, external rotation. With any shoulder movement, it is smooth and concentric so that the ball is smoothly aligned within the capsule. With abnormal movement, such as a weak posterior stabilizer, with a front dominant pull of the shoulder, the joint is decentered, what we call subluxation. This results in anterior impingement and shoulder injury. So the function of the rotator cuff is to pull the humeral head together against the glenoid to compress it and stabilize it. That's what we term as a synergistic co-contraction of all four rotator cuff muscles simultaneously. So the problem is always when we exercise accelerating muscles versus the decelerating muscles, power movers versus the braking muscles. This muscle imbalance sets up a fertile ground for injury and imbalance. So the function of the rotator cuff is not to rotate the shoulder, but rather to act as what we call eccentric decelerators to counteract against the opposing accelerators that move the shoulder. This synergistic simultaneous co-contraction creates this glenohumeral compression effect that keeps the center humeral head and compressed. Shoulder performance in throw athletes is predicated on shoulder acceleration, not necessarily shoulder strength. We see that even in track and field meets, got to have a strong starting block that stabilizes the opposing force for the takeoff. Swim meets, we have a stable starting block in order to accelerate. Baseball pitchers have a block. Even race cars utilize large, beefy wheels to serve as a point of stability to allow acceleration. Cricket players, the sudden stop of the front foot serve as a starting block for the propulsion of the rest of the body forward. So the rotator cuff is the starting block for the shoulder for any acceleration movements. The shoulder is compressed together by the four rotator cuffs contracting simultaneously to allow this abutment and a smooth fulcrum motion. And again, serves as a hand cropping out, grabbing securely onto this ball. So the problem is, how do we preferentially activate and strengthen the four rotator cuff muscles that is small to stabilize against the 13 larger power accelerators? Traditional exercises are linearly based, whether directionally based, such as pulling elastic bands, or gravity dependent, such as lifting weights. We train throwing velocity with power accelerator training. These are all consisted of one of those four moves, the push, pull, lift, or the press. Sometimes we combine that with rubber bands, dumbbell weights in different directions, or even use slam balls. These build big muscles, so-called shoulder exercises. We try sometimes to creatively concoct specific movement techniques utilizing rubber bands to try to train the rotator cuff stabilizers, such as in this video depicting. But as the arm is moving, the rotator cuff has to respond and to stabilize. EMG studies have shown that the rotator cuff muscles actually fire just prior to arm movement. This pre-activation, pre-motion stabilization anchors the shoulder joint. As the arm moves up, the rotator cuff has to fight against this more powerful force to stabilize the shoulder in the opposite direction. Otherwise, will suffer injury. Every force must be met by an equal and opposite force in order to maintain shoulder stability. So the rotator cuff muscles must fire all four of them simultaneously. They must be engaging and adjust rapidly to any changes in arm position. The power accelerator training, linearly driven, but is there a way to specifically train the braking muscles, the decelerators, the four rotator cuff muscles simultaneously in isolation to separate away from the power accelerators? So now we have the question of, is there a rotator cuff specific exercise versus the so-called shoulder exercises? The challenge again is, how do we fight against the 80% power larger muscles that is involved with any shoulder movement, counteracting against the four smaller stabilizer muscles that only comprise of the 20% of all the moving muscles? So the goal is, how do we reverse this pattern to impactfully strengthen 80% of the effort into the small stabilizer muscles and allow the larger muscles to be more quiet? The so-called rotator cuff exercises consist of lying on the side with a lighter dumbbell. Not a bad exercise. But I would submit that any form of exercise, even with this pushing the weight upwards, require engagement of rotator cuff it is also indirectly a form of rotator cuff exercise. So when we pull and push these bands, is this considered as a rotator cuff exercise, or is that really just a shoulder exercise? So we're starting to become more confused now. Rotator cuff versus shoulder exercise. With any strength training, it should be purposeful and meaningful. To create a more powerful forehand to play tennis is different from spiking a volleyball. So the workouts must be made to be meaningful so that we understand what we are training for. So the typical rotator cuff exercise, such as lying on the side, kind of boring. Not very purposeful. Pulling bands in different directions, starting to look pointless. Very strong shoulder stability training for the rotator cuff to stabilize the shoulder, or even challenge ourselves with even heavier weights to make the rotator cuff even stronger. Is it purposeful? Unless we want to lift weights from the ground up or lifting heavy dishes behind our body. Rotator cuff strength for shoulder stability does not equate to thrower's shoulder health. Shoulder health and performance are related to acceleration, not strength. Here's another exercise that's commonly performed by throwers. It is functional, but may not be purposeful unless we want to be very good in dropping balls while facing down. Another common exercise being tossing the ball up and backwards. It is functional, but does it bring meaning to what we play on the field unless we want to throw the ball backwards? We will be very good at it. This so-called rhythmic stabilization requires a second pair of hands to maintain the stability. Very good close chain exercise, good co-contraction. But again, is it meaningful or relevant to the thrower? Another form of exercise where we use multiple trainers to guide the shoulder, to challenge the shoulder for rhythmic stabilization. Again, it is functional, but may not be too meaningful and not very actively specific for throwers. Popular exercise of oscillating shoulder blade, one plane workout, good arm exercise, but is it purposeful and meaningful for throwers? So the questions remain, how can we meaningfully train synergistic co-contraction of all the four rotator cuff muscles? How do we isolate? How do we know that all four muscles are engaged? Is there a way to track and measure the power of output? Sport-specific training should be activity-specific, event-driven, to be meaningful and purposeful. The first description of rotator cuff tear was in 1834. That was 40 years BT, what I call before telephone. That was the first telephone invented in 1800s. First rotator cuff surgery was in 1909. That's 40 years after the invention of the telephone. That's the telephone in the early 1900s. In the 1960s, we started to use rubber bands and weights to train and strengthen our rotator cuff because of our knowledge of rotator cuff. More than half a century later, the age of smartphone, the rotator cuff exercises still remain to be rubber bands and weights. So welcome to the 21st century, something different now. This is Shoulder Sphere. The future of rotator cuff strengthening is rotationally based, not linear. This way you can train both concentric and eccentric activity synergistically as one functional unit. This is a video of the shoulder sphere. On the top is a smaller F2, which is a 2-ounce ball. And the lower one is a larger one. It's A7. It's a 7-ounce ball. This is the internal anatomy of the shoulder sphere. As the ball is rotating, you can track this out as a sine wave curve. As the ball goes in one direction, you can call this concentric contraction, opposite direction, eccentric. So the ball is rotating rapidly, concentric, eccentric, concentric, eccentric activity. When the ball is being rotated rapidly at 4 to 8 times per second, as far as the brain is concerned, this is a simultaneous event. That's how you can train all four simultaneously. The speed of the rotation corresponds to the speed of muscle contraction. Lack of data is like driving your car with no speedometer. We have sophisticated tools these days that train and measure the flight metrics, speed guns that measure the speed, even dynamometers that measure the strength of particularly with external rotation or internal rotation strength for the rotator cuff, but none measure the braking power or the rotator cuff deceleration power that is required. Cars should only go as fast as can stop. Throwing arm power is equal to arm care that is related to power of decelerators, not the accelerators. Today's training, we train to go fast. The data tells us how fast we can go. Shoulder sphere training specifically trains for how fast you can stop, not how fast you can go. It trains for shoulder to be anchored by the rotator cuff as one functional unit to serve as a takeoff platform for the shoulder to accelerate. Shoulder sphere training is based on science, physics, and our contemporary knowledge of shoulder kinematics. Here's an example. Bauer's 90 mile per hour pitch requires a shoulder power of 40 foot-pounds per second. This is the power that is required to accelerate, but more importantly, to decelerate so as to avoid injury. It also is the power to engage the shoulder to allow acceleration. Softball pitch of over 55 miles per hour requires a power measured to be over 35 pounds per second. And again, that is the power required to go and to stop. Distance of 400 feet, 85 feet, 200 feet. Throwing distance is equal to velocity. That predicts the minimum deceleration power needed by the rotator cuff. With Jeter's jump first base throw, 150 feet, or throw from outfield to home, 400 feet. What really is the minimum velocity that is required to cover that distance? The actual throwing velocity by these athletic players can be faster, but the question is, what is the minimum velocity that is required? So this way, we can know what is the minimum rotator cuff power that is required in order for an individual to participate in that activity. We need to understand a little bit about the physics of projectile objects. Number one law is that whatever goes up must come down. So we're fighting against gravity at acceleration speed of 9.8 meters per second per second, or English system of 32 feet per second per second. We also have the known, what is the distance to be thrown. We know the launch angle of throwing. We also know that from calculations that the farthest distance with the lowest velocity tolerated take a parabolic trajectory and the takeoff angle is at 45 degrees. By knowing these variables, we can calculate what is the minimum launch velocity required. So here's some examples. At same 45 degrees of launch angle, at 30 meters per second throw, cover distance of 90 meters, faster, further distance, of course, 50 meters, cover the furthest. Now, if we just want to throw the same distance, different takeoff angle at 70 degrees requires a velocity of 37 meters per second. At 30 degree takeoff angle, about 32 meters per second. Now, at the same velocity of 50 meters per second, we know that the takeoff angle at 45 degrees is optimal, covers the farthest distance. These can be all calculated out by fancy calculus and equations, but spare you the pain. We just go down to the final formula derived that the range of the distance to be covered is directly related to the velocity of throw, related to the launch angle, and indirectly related to the gravity. So the minimum velocity with a takeoff angle at 45 degrees, we can calculate that as to be the square root of the distance times gravity. So, and the power required to throw is related to the weight of the ball, throwing velocity, and throwing distance, which translate to what is the rotator cuff power required to decelerate. So putting all together, jitter is 150 feet, minimum velocity of 48 miles per hour. Perhaps faster he threw it, but the minimum requirement is 48. Minimum rotator cuff power is 24 foot-pounds per second. Pitcher, minimum velocity of 30 miles per hour. Don't know if you have witnessed Dr. Fauci's starting baseball throw with at the start of the baseball season. He could hardly reach home plate. So we know in order to reach home plate, a minimum velocity of 30 miles per hour must be reached. And the rotator cuff must have a power of 15 foot-pounds per second. Chapman's throw 100 miles per hour translates to 50 foot-pound per second of power. 300 feet outfield, 67. Between bases, 38 miles per hour, 20 foot-pound. Softball pitcher, minimum of 25 miles per hour because the softball is a little bit heavier than baseball. Monica Abbott's world record, 77 miles per hour, translates to a 50 foot-pound per second power. Softball between bases, 35 miles per hour. Outfield, 55 miles per hour. So these all can be calculated. That is physics. We note that the Chapman's 100 miles per hour, 50 foot-pound, is similar to Monica Abbott. That 50 foot-pound per second is the human limit for the power of the rotator cuff. So just for the fun, a little digression, we can talk about Patrick Mahomes' 80-yard football throw during the pro day while he was in college in 2017 at Texas Tech. Awesome 80-yard throw. So we can calculate that. The minimum launch velocity had to be 60 miles per hour. Football about 15 ounces. The power is actually 83 foot-pound per second. He played baseball. His fastball in high school was 94 miles per hour. That translates to a power of 47 foot-pounds. So does this make sense? When he threw the football, it was at 83, but baseball was only 47. Why is that so? Yes, indeed, because the aerodynamic flight of the shape of the football can travel two times further during a tight spiral. So we cannot escape the laws of physics. Now, how does stratosphere train the power of deceleration? A little bit of understanding of the physics of rotating objects. Some simple formulas. Force is equal to mass times acceleration. But because of a rotational object, this is an angular acceleration of velocity squared over the radius. We know the work is divided equal to the force times distance and the power and so forth. Shoulder Sphere comes with an electronic power tracker. When rotating at a slow velocity, it is in green. In high velocity, it is red. So here's some calculation. At low power, under 200 rotations per minute, is equivalent to the power required to throw a tennis ball about 40 feet. Or if you're playing baseball, 60 miles per hour. Softball, 20 miles per hour. When you're able to get the tracker light up in red, high power, more than 400 times RPM, is equal to throwing a tennis ball 80 feet. Or if you use the larger A7 version, that prepares you to throw 90 miles per hour, or softball, or 55 miles per hour. So Shoulder Sphere can be used as an assessment tool in addition to a training tool. If the user cannot spin the large A7 model fast enough to get a power tracker in red light for more than 3 seconds, then pretty much can forget about throwing a baseball at 90 miles per hour or a softball at 55 miles per hour. Or if a person indicates that my baseball velo is at 90, but I cannot get into red, that is a strong prediction to get injured, see you in the operating room, or be a bench warmer. So here's some simple comparisons just to take out some exercise. We use a light rubber band and a dumbbell of 2 pounds, which is equivalent to a tan color rubber band. And we move this for 3 seconds. But in Shoulder Sphere, we can use a smaller version with a 2 ounce ball. We spin it for 3 seconds, keeping it in red. So what do we get? We get the total work done using the 2 pound dumbbell as 4 foot-pounds, same amount of time, 25 foot pounds. 6 times more work involved using the smaller Shoulder Sphere. The power, 1.3, power using the smaller Shoulder Sphere, 8.3. 6 times more power engaged. Here's a typical exercise with the Turkish get up, 70 pounds and versus the A7 Shoulder Sphere doing exactly the same move. This takes about 40 seconds to do because trying to spin the large 7 ounce Shoulder Sphere, keeping it in red light. So 7 ounces versus 70 pounds. Note that the arm does not move, only the ball moves. That is rotator cuff isolation. So the Turkish get up, for gentlemen of 5'11", 33 seconds, moving this 70 pounds for that height, and for the 7 ounce ball, you spin that fast, keep it in red light for 40 seconds. So the work done is 384. With a Shoulder Sphere, 2,000, more than 6 times more work done in the same amount of time. Power engaged, 11.6 foot-pound per second. Power engaged, 63 foot-pound per second for the Shoulder Sphere. Even though it's a 7 ounce ball, but the power involved is 5 times more. That makes this a super efficient workout. In other words, you only have to work out 5 seconds to be more effective in the result than another weightlifting program of 30 seconds. Why is that? Because of physics. F equals ma, and the power is due to the rotating objects of angular acceleration increases exponentially as opposed to linearly pulled the rubber band or lifting weights. Now, can I prove that? Doing Shoulder Sphere, pulling rubber bands, lifting a little bit, and using the body plate. You can see that with Shoulder Sphere, the EMG data show very tightly compact, high activity. Pulling the rubber band, less activity. Lifting dumbbell, even more so, a lot less. And the muscle is continuously contracted with the shoulder sphere because it is both concentric and eccentric. With a rubber band, there is less of a contractility, and with dumbbell, even less. Here's a video with pulling rubber band. You can see the muscles fires on and off. But with the shoulder sphere, it is always engaged because it's a concentric greater than 6 times per second. It is a simultaneous contraction. This has been published in the Journal of Strength and Conditioning Research in the November 2019 issue. So now, for sports-specific training, this is a decelerator power training as opposed to weightlifting power training for the accelerators. We're not trying to go fast, but we're trying to go slow. By doing it slowly, we amplify the shoulder performance, prevent shoulder injury. We can predict who's going to get hurt. And after injury, perfect tool for rehabilitation and also an assessment tool prior to return to play. So by using science and physics, we train with intent for rotator cuff decelerating power that is needed for throwing velocity. Motor pattern simulation of throwing velocity, we train the rotator cuff responsiveness in a multi-directional manner, adjusting to the various spatial positions that is required. The training is not for big muscle of throwing fast, but how fast the rotator cuff can stop. How fast you can stop translates to shoulder injury prevention and indirectly actually amplifies the throwing velocity because you have a much more solid starting block. The shoulder sphere can be used as a pre-activity warm-up, just 10 simulation throws using a small one prior to pitch, 5 after you play as a cool down. If you're a switch hitter, and if you're powerful enough to do simultaneously, batting practice with a large one. So this is activity specific to mirror the event that is anticipated. If you're a catcher, you simulate the environment as closely as possible so as to strengthen the power of the rotator cuff deceleration. When you're an elite crooked fast bowler, you can concentrate on the 3 static positions of the shoulder that is most vulnerable during throwing activity, in back of the body, in horizontal, when the shoulder is straight up at 12 o'clock position, and with the shoulder in the front of the body, horizontal during deceleration. But again, you notice that there's virtually 0 arm movement. The ball is spinning entirely due to the rotator cuff. Your rotator cuff, imagine as electricity shooting down the arm, making the ball spin. So no large arm movements. So that is power from the rotator cuff. For novice users, usually they move the arm quite a bit in order to make the ball spin. That is a reflection of the weakness of the rotator cuff. Or you can change it up a little bit with generalized body balance training using the small shoulder sphere or the large shoulder sphere, whatever one wishes. Even simulation for fast bowlers in cricket. So you simulate exactly what one does. As a pitcher, using the coaching ring as shown here, actually amplifies the rotator power by twofold. So it's by trying to pass the ring itself, makes the workout significantly more difficult. So you try to simulate the activity that one is engaged in. Wherever the hand goes in space, the rotator cuff and the shoulder sphere can be trained. Softball training for multi-directional engagement to train the responsiveness of the rotator cuff to stay engaged to keep the shoulder stable. You can have combination moving from below to the top, to simulate the throwing motion. There are actually programs on the website that you can consult with the training routine. So, in summary, thank you very much. I can be reached at win@shouldersphere.com.